Hey again, friends. Welcome to This Cultural Moment, a podcast about following Jesus in the post-Christian world. John Mark Comer here with Mark Sayers, sitting in the basement of First Baptist Church. We're beginning to chat about systems theory and the way that the secular post-Christian world that we live in, if you're in a Portland or a Melbourne or wherever you call home or have access to through your phone, is a system. And unfortunately, there are all sorts of signs that it's a failing system. There's this feedback loop saying something is not right. The new anger, the anxiety, the low-grade exhaustion, the radical sense of transience, the lack, the breakdown of the family. There's a sense that something about the system itself is off. In this episode, we continue our conversation on systems theory and begin to look at forms of renewal in this system that we call home.
Renewal is this process that God keeps us taking us on, that He's written into, I think, the fabric of the cosmos, because humans always must choose to choose God again.
Mark, so we're in the system. The system is failing. The signs are all over the place, even as people are living the good life if you're in the right part of the right city, but yet wrecked by anxiety, isolation, commitment phobia, choice anxiety, father wounds, the breakdown of the family. I mean, all this stuff under the facade of the kind of I'm a happy, educated Western person. As we begin to look forward, are there ways that God does work to renew or revive systems?
I think that's a really good way of understanding how God comes to renew us. That what He wants to do is to come into our system and flood our systems with His presence. That's essential what the theology of renewal is. That humans...
And when you say renewal, do you mean that as kind of a synonym for revival?
I use the word renewal. It's used in many different ways. You have three words, really. You have awakening, which is often used in this country to describe what happened in the 18th and 19th centuries. The same movement as it happened across the other side of the Atlantic is often called revival, which came out of Wesley and Whitfield. Renewal is a word that started to be used as different people wrote about the process of revival, like Richard Lovelace and Howard Snyder. I tend to use renewal because I like it. You can use it personally. Mm-hmm. So my definition of revival, which is how I describe it, is when renewal goes viral. Hmm. And goes into the wider cultural systems. That's how I define it. That's just my little thing.
Got it. No, that's fantastic. Keep going.
So the sense that our systems trend to becoming chaff, to failing, to any human endeavor, the story of the Tower of Babel tells us, has this Babelic kill switch in it when it tries to power itself on human power, not God's presence. That is just one of the overarching themes
yes,
of Scripture.
It inevitably starts to collapse in on itself.
So our man-made hands fall like sand through our hand. What did I just say? Our man-made plans fall like sand through our hands. I think that's a favela lyric. But this sense that anything that we do apart from God is going to fail. So there's this sense that we need to be continually renewed. So renewal is this process that God keeps us taking us on, that He's written into, I think, the fabric of the cosmos, because humans always must choose to choose God again in order to dwell in the vine. That helps us understand that, A, God wants to renew us, and renewal is how God grows us. It's how He refreshes us as individual. It's how He refreshes the church. It's how He refreshes cultures and cities and nations and continents. But when we understand renewal, the problem is in a post-Christian society and in the West is we have this faux renewal. Now, not many people would think about it, but really, in a sense, the West is built on a secular caricature of revivalism. Hmm. And one of the words that we use to describe history and this turning point in history is when we went from the era of the church, the era of Christendom, into then the beginning of the modern era, which people call the Renaissance. So a big...
Or the Renaissance.
Oh, sorry.
American.
Yes.
Renaissance, we would say. But I'm well aware that it's
like
not how you pronounce
aluminium
the French word.
And aluminum. So Renaissance. And... What's really interesting, so there's a Pulitzer Prize-winning, big-selling book by Stephen Greenblatt. I think it won the Pulitzer Prize in 2011. And the story he tells in that book is...
What's the title of the book?
Called The Swerve.
Got it.
So he uses that image of the swerve, that society was heading in this terrible direction, And then it makes these swerves and trends into the grandeur of the modern world. And so he tells the story of Poggio Bracciolini, who's this Vatican official who's a book hunter. And whilst he works for the church, he doesn't really believe in it. And one day he's looking through this collection of books and he discovers this book from the ancient world, this text. And it's Lucretius's book on the nature of things. Lucretius was a follower who took the thought of Epicurus, which is where we get the word Epicurean from.
It was an ancient Greek school of philosophy, right? Yes. Very influential.
Who believed in, you know, looking for, ask the question, are there gods? Who knows? So instead, let's pursue pleasure is a sort of, you know,
yes.
Cliff Notes version.
Hence the adjective Epicurean.
Exactly. So Lucretius, you know, is part of this school of thought in the ancient world, which says maybe just the world is just atoms. And so it's almost then sort of posited as by Greenblatt as this moment where the modern world rediscovers this ancient truth that was forgotten. And so we go back to this idealized, you know, utopian period in the past, the Eden of the West. And therefore he discovers this sacred text. He starts to read it and other people start to read it. And this is the essence of where our modern atheistic, hedonistic world goes back to. Now, what's really interesting, Renaissance in the old French means revival. Now, some of you listening at home will start to see some of the contours of a revivalist schema. Revivalism looks to the purity and vitality of the early church. It feels it's in a period where through neglect or even heresy, the vitality of that early period is gone.
It's gone.
It wants to get back to scripture and to get back to the essence of what it was and to take that vitality and put it into the future. And that's going to create a...
You're saying that's Christian revivalism.
Christian revivalism.
Renewal.
Yeah, Christian
renewal.
And you're
starting to compare this to secular renewal.
Yes.
Am I hearing you?
So if you listen to how the story's been told, it's this. The ancient world, Greek-Roman world, was some sort of idealized world. This is the reason why the Enlightenment founders of this country, if you go to Washington, a lot of the buildings look like Greco-Roman buildings. Edward Gibbon wrote the book, you know, on the decline of Rome, where here was this great society, but then what killed it? The heresy that killed it was Christianity, superstition and religion. So Bracciolini then discovers this text and Lucretius's book on the nature of things. It's like discovering the New Testament.
Yes, like back to the book of Acts or something.
Exactly.
Like that.
And he reads it. Oh, wow. Actually, there were these people in the past who just believed the world was just atoms. And it's about enjoying things and it's about pleasure. So we need to get back to that. The Western world's gone wrong. So this is this idea of a swerve. So we need a renaissance,
a revival,
a return, a revival, a rebirth. Now, what's really interesting is that the term Renaissance is not something, you know, people weren't walking around, you know, Medici, Florence going, hey, we're in the Renaissance. The word Renaissance
came later.
Jakob Burckhardt, who is a Swiss German
historian. I read him all the time. Yeah. One of my faves.
Good bathroom reading. who was in Calvinist, I think he was in Geneva. And then he uses that historical thing to speak against, in a sense, the church in his day. I think his father was a Calvinist minister. So in a sense, the term Renaissance really comes in the sort of modernist era. So it's a historical revisionism. But that's sort of basic street-level secularism, I call it. So there's great books on secularism at the moment. You know, you can read Charles Taylor's book on secularism or Jamie Smith's, you know, sort of
summary
of it. But the average punter in the West, is that
what's a punter?
Okay, the average
punter
is like
baseball punter.
Okay, a punter is someone who bets. So it's a sort of UK
gambler?
English Australians, like your average punter is your man in the street.
Okay, so just your average person on the street,
average bloke on the corner. is they have a view of secularism which isn't as sophisticated as some of these books. They believe, many of them, whether they're believers or not, that there was this time where there was heaps of people going to church, they're not anymore, and inevitably secularism is going to become the thing which takes over. That the world, in a sense, will get better when we get rid of belief. So we're actually living in this inverted sense of revivalism. It has the contours of revivalism, but it's a secular version of it.
Wow, interesting.
So that then changes how we view Christianity, because what it makes it feel is it makes the Christian feel like they're there in this place of fragility, because even Christians have bought into the secular, crude, street level idea of renewal. So when you talk about renewal at a time like this, people think, oh, is that really at this time?
Yeah, there's
time?
No way. That might have happened back in the day, but now it's inevitable. The church is in decline. Secularism will triumph. That's the narrative.
Yes.
That's easy to believe.
So everything that we've been talking about in the previous episodes of this series is all pointing to the fact that we're getting to this cultural point of failure. And when cultural points of failure happen, it's a feedback that the system isn't working. And often what secularism can be, or what the secularism at the moment can feel like, is there's an absence of God's presence. So that's another definition of secularism. Secularism is attempting to get progress without presence.
Mm-hmm. It's an attempt to live as if there's no God, or if there is, he's not involved, or it's not involved, or whatever.
And James Burns, who wrote about revival, said there's moments in history where it seems like the tide of faith has gone out. But if you've been to a beach and it's tide, you know, the tide is going out, you know that behind the breakers, there's a force ready to come back. And the longer that wave goes out and you're standing on the edge of the water, you could be swamped soon.
Yes.
And so I think we're at one of those moments.
And there is that revisionist history where we think, you know, 500 years ago, everybody was a Christian, and there's just been this slow and steady decline over the last five centuries into secularism. But if you go back and do your research, that does not compute. That is not reality. It is much more, I like that word picture of the tide in and out. There have just been these moments of renewal followed by moments of stagnation.
Exactly. So we have this false post-Christian view of secular revivalism.
Mm-hmm.
But also there's a...
Because the tide came in on secularism.
Yes.
And now you're saying the tide is coming out,
yes,
which could potentially mean the tide's coming in,
yes,
for the way of Jesus.
And also what it means is people are freaking out and anxious because the secular revival seems to be failing.
Hmm.
So they're at the point of like, we've been meeting, we've been praying, we've been singing our secular songs,
yep,
and it ain't coming. And so it's now having a moment of doubt.
And you're seeing this at a society-wide level. Do you see this at an individual level?
That's a great question, because not only do we have a post-Christian secular revivalist concept that's crude and street level
kind of
in our minds.
Overall, the Western world, kind of if you're in America or England or Oz, wherever.
Yes. We also have this secularized personal post-Christian view of renewal, which still has the contours of Christian salvation in it. So Dan McAdams wrote a really interesting book called The Redemptive Self, which was looking at how Americans view their lives currently. And what he said was the religiosity of America means that whilst we're living secular lives, it still has these Christian contours to it, and it's still shaped by a sense of Christian redemption, salvation, discipleship, yet with secular content.
Okay, map that out for me.
I mean, just do a little sketch. So there's this idea of Eden, if you think about the Christian schema, that in the past there was this time, mm-hmm, where we were unfallen. We were like, you know, walking in God's presence in
naked
innocence.
And unashamed.
No, yep, shame.
In the garden.
Yeah, so we hear this language of the inner child or the inner self, that somehow at some point I had this happiness.
And you're saying that's the secular version.
That's the
of
secular
the Eden
version
narrative
of the Eden.
Is
and, yes,
the inner child before you were despoiled by your, yes, environment, your family of origin.
Yeah, so you hear these things like, oh, it's just been so busy at work and it's been such a horrible year and I just need to go camping because I just need to get in touch with who I am. I need to sit with who I am. I feel like my inner child spoke for the first time. I feel like my true self, like they talk about this reconnection with yourself. So then, of course, in the Christian schema, you have the fall. You have,
yeah,
sin.
Yeah, creation, then fall.
Yes. So we talk about these in different ways. One is trauma is in many ways a contemporary fall. That something then happened to me. There's a time when I was innocent, and maybe that trauma was in childhood, or maybe when it was I got divorced, or maybe when it's this thing happened at school. The sense of trauma comes in. We also talk about binding commitments as something which then stop our happiness.
Wow.
Adulthood, responsibility, yep, externally given identities, traditions. So the example of the novel you gave before, you know, I was in Nigeria and there's all this binding stuff in Nigerian culture, but then I go to America and I reinvent myself and I run off and have an affair and discover who I really am.
Because any form of commitment, even responsibility, and definitely any form of authority is seen as an obstruction to your inner child, your true self.
And so what those things bring, the fall of, yeah, responsibility, outwardly, you know, outward restrictions, externally given identities, what they do is then they bring sin. Sin, therefore, in this schema is low self-esteem and unhappiness.
Because the point of life is essentially to be happy in the secular worldview.
Yes.
Therefore, sin becomes anything that makes you unhappy, which we have redefined as pleasure. So it makes you not feel pleasure in the moment. You say that?
Yes. So Epicureanism. Epicureanism is we don't have the big picture, so let's have pleasure. When we're not having pleasure, this is the equivalent of
which is a radical redefinition of happiness. I read that book, The Hacking of the American Mind, recently. And he's not a Christian, but his basic prognosis is that we have confused happiness with pleasure.
Yes.
And he's a doctor, so he comes at it neurobiologically. Happiness is about serotonin.
Yes.
Pleasure is about endorphins, and they do radically different. He talks about discontentment and contentment, how happiness is based on contentment.
Mm.
Like you're happy when you're like, all is well with the world. But in a capitalistic economy, you make money off of discontentment.
Yes, yes.
And so like we're freighted to redefine happiness as pleasure, which means pleasure is something you always need more of. The second your glass is empty, you need a refill. The second that you experience is over, you need another. The second the romantic partner falls off, you need another romantic high or whatever. And so it's this never-ending kind of hamster wheel. And that's what you're saying. Sin is anything that is unhappiness,
yes,
which has been redefined as doesn't make me feel pleasure in the moment.
And that's a key point you bring up. Philip Cushman, who's a psychologist, wrote on another book on the creation of the American self. And he says exactly, consumerism is now invested in perpetuating this model.
Because that's how you make money off of the consumer, is make them perpetually discontent or unhappy.
Yes. So you're incomplete, but when you buy this new gadget or you have this vacation.
Or you travel to the space, or you get this sexual escapade, or you redefine.
Yes. So then salvation becomes rediscovering your inner self.
Okay, so this is so good. So creation. Eden is your inner child, your true self before you were wrecked by your environment.
Yes.
The fall becomes, you know, trauma, binding commitments, externally given identities, traditions that were imposed upon you, expectations on you. Sin becomes unhappiness
or
any kind of low self-esteem, anything that makes you feel bad about yourself and your situation in life.
Can I just add to one thing there?
Yeah.
And it's even gone beyond just I'm having a terrible experience. It's now anything difficult, the difficult conversation, the concept I don't want to think about, the fact that I've got to go to work and I've got to do stuff I don't want to do, even that is now becoming seen as sin.
Gosh. Okay, so in the Christian schema, you go creation, fall, and sin, then to salvation or redemption. What does redemption or salvation look like in the secular framework?
Rediscovering your inner self. Centeredness. Centeredness is I'm now centered in on who I am. I am now at peace because I've discovered who I am. I just like when you think about this, you know, go on a vacation. I'm going to leave my job and go traveling. Why? To rediscover who I really am.
Mm-hmm.
That's the money you want. And so the Christian schema is to die to self, go outside and find the transcendent other God.
Live a holy life.
This is to discover who you are. So this still has this sense of holiness.
Yeah, because it's a moral vision. The secular vision is a moral vision.
So holiness is, if you flee from sin in the Christian schema,
mm-hmm.
here you flee from its version of sin. So if its sin is externally given identities, if it's binding commitments, if it's difficult things, holiness is fleeing from commitments, restrictions on autonomy, and externally given identities.
Oh, my gosh.
So holiness is commitment phobia in the post-Christian schema.
To anything external.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So In the Christian schema, redemption is tied in with discipleship. You have to follow Jesus into this new life. And that is about obedience to Jesus and his vision of human flourishing. What's discipleship in the secular schema?
It is our achievement culture. It is hitting a number of metrics which end up shaping your outer self, created identity. So if you can shape an outer self that is attractive to others, that feels like an expression of yourself, self-expression.
That makes you feel good in the moment.
Yes, and you can create this identity which reflects your inner self, then you get to heaven, and heaven is pleasure and happiness.
Ah, okay, so in the Christian schema, the end is heaven or new creation, and you're saying in the secular schema, it's pleasure and happiness, which again, we've defined as feeling good about yourself and your situation or pleasure in the moment.
Yes. So anytime we're trying to pursue Christian redemption, this is there confusing because it looks Christian. And so much of cultural Christianity or even prosperity gospel in its extreme, or
which is a weird mix of these two. It's a mix of both. That's super interesting.
And this is sort of almost the Oprahization of spirituality. Mm-hmm. This sense that there are people in our churches who think they're pursuing Jesus's way, but it's sort of a Christian veneer over this post-Christian redemptive renewal system. So this is why we don't change our system. We just go, oh, okay, to get that, I want Jesus. So just more freedom, more of this stuff.
Yes.
I want Jesus to help me get inside, you know, in touch with my inner child.
Help me feel pleasure. Help me be my true self.
Yes.
Help me get past my trauma.
So I come
which
to
is beautiful.
Yeah. Oh, exactly.
But then all of a sudden, Jesus has an identity for you as a son, as a daughter, and a way of life that we disciple into.
And it's a narrow path. It's dying to self. So, you know, I come to Bridgetown. I want to reconnect with my faith. And all of a sudden, I'm going, this community, this sounds wonderful. This looks great. But now I'm 7 weeks in.
But it's
narrow. There's some annoying people.
I love the definition. Glenn Stassen, who is one of my favorite writers on the Sermon on the Mount, does great work around Jesus teaching on the narrow way. And he pushes back a little bit about the kind of more fundamentalist reading of that, if a few people are going to heaven and everybody else is going to hell. And he says, and actually, the idea of a narrow way is it's a very specific path that you follow to get to life.
Yes.
And it's less about who's in and who's out, and more about there's a very specific way to live as an apprentice of Jesus. It's narrow, meaning it's specific. It's not just the broad way, which is just do whatever the heck you want, be true to yourself, follow your desire, just go do the thing. It's a specific, narrow way to live that leads to life. And the end result of it is life in the kingdom. And the Sermon on the Mount is a map for that narrow way of life, a way of forgiveness, a way of peace, a non-anxious presence, a way that's not lustful, that's not angry, a way of forgiveness, a way of life together in community, a way of not of doing the right things for the right reasons, generosity but not to show. It's the specific way to live, but that's anathema in the secular schema, which is basically just go do whatever the heck you want. Don't let anybody stop you.
So, I mean, to summarize, this secular cultural revival is failing. The secular personal renewal schema is failing. That's good news because it creates an opening. And for people listening, it actually creates a whole new way of looking at that map of meaning. Our map of meaning, how we've interpreted our lives in the West, is wrong. And the map of meaning that we have is beginning to fail. And we have this incredible moment where you have a chance to actually change. There's a saying, if you want to change your system, change the inputs. So people hearing this, you go, oh man, that's I've got a weird mashup of Christianity and that secular.
And prosperity gospel
and secularism.
And
I didn't even realize I hate prosperity gospel, but I'm actually following it. There is an opportunity to change your inputs, and inputs is presence, and inputs is following his presence.
Oh, at the end of the day, everything comes back to that. Thanks for listening to be with us. We're so grateful. Hey, we're still a new podcast, so if you want to spread the word, tell your family, tell your friends, post something online, write us a review on iTunes. There's no marketing wing. There's no part-time Instagram social media person. There's just us in the basement, Mark Sayers, myself, the producer, Dave Lukenhalter over here, the producer, meaning my buddy, who's here with the laptop.
Hidden third of the triangle.
Yeah, so if you want to spread the word, fantastic. But thanks so much for listening to This Cultural Moment.